Hello, everybody. Welcome to this episode of Women Making Big Sales. Today, we're going to be talking about how she did it, Angelie Brown. She is the founder of FranchiseFix, and she has been in the hospitality industry, franchising industries, and recruiting industry for 20 years, tons of sales experience. The first time we reached out to her and I say, hey, you know, you want to know more about sales? And she told me, hey, I know everything about sales. And that's when I realized that I need to talk to this lady and pick her brain and share her journey. So I've got so many questions to ask her. Hello, Angelie. Welcome to Women Making Big Sales.
Hi, Melinda. Thank you so much. I'm so happy to be here. I really appreciate it.
Awesome. All right. So why don't you first let us know a little bit of your like sales journey? I support women that go after business clients and corporate clients. And the first time we talked, I was amazed by the amount of sales experience you've got from the beginning of the hospitality to recruiting and to franchising. Could you just share with me a little bit of like, just take us through that sales journey?
Certainly. Happy to do so. It's a fun story. So first of all, I always like to start when I'm explaining my background and history and things that I've done is that I like to start from the center of who I am as a human being. I feel that the time that we spent on our last conversation was fantastic and we shared a lot of great stories. And I think it's important to relate that information back as well. So and just take some of those nuggets. So a little bit about me. I was a very young mom. I ended up having a very young family, got married at 21. I started out as a leader in my community working in hospitality. And at 26, I ended up running my own franchise and really got thrown into the fire. And so at this point, when I was a young mom and three kids and the house and all of these responsibilities, I found myself as this young entrepreneur and business owner and really learning on the fly. And I think as women, we do that really well. I mean, I feel that we are extremely resourceful and we need to go and just find and seek what we need to do and on zero sleep and trying to change diapers while trying to go out there and make a living and make a difference, you know, we somehow make it work. And so I definitely had a very interesting journey as my first time being an entrepreneur, and I had a very deep task. And a lot of the drive and the passion really came from my center of who I am as a person. You know, I was raised in an environment as an oldest sibling. I've always done a lot of work in my community. I think giving back is extremely important. It's those core values that I instilled into my children as well. They've done a ton of community work. So I really wanted to make sure as my first time entrepreneur or going into that business that I was really following my path and my core of my value of who I am as a person. So I basically took a very underperforming store and put together a strategy to build that store from doing close to about $400,000 in sales. And we built that up over $1.2 million in sales, becoming the number one store in the chain in just 6 months. So
That's amazing.
I didn't even expect to get that good results. I did not build that in the plan, I'll be honest, but I had to make a lot of really tough decisions because it's not just sales. I mean, having a great customer service mindset and making sure that that's instilled in my team was like number one that had to happen. But then number two, I had to learn very quickly that I needed to make a lot of very tough decisions as an entrepreneur that I really wasn't ready to do because I really liked always being that nice person. You know, coming from hospitality, it's about making it right, making sure the guest is always happy. I was a concierge for a five diamond hotel. And so I had really grown up in that experience of just making magic happen. And when you realize that maybe you need to make changes in staff or maybe you need to be a little bit more astute when it comes to you know, maybe there's internal theft and some things like that that I might have had to, I'm not saying I specifically went through that, but maybe I might have. And so there's all of these challenges. But we got through it. We got through it just fine. Store turned out great. It was a wonderful experience. And I hit that point in my career that I just went, okay, I did it. Great. But I realized this wasn't for me. Went through a lot of personal sacrifices. I worked a lot more than what I expected. I was still a very young mom. My daughter was just a year and a half, 2 years old at the time. And I had this crazy journey that I love to talk about being an entrepreneur for the first time, is that I thought, okay, I'm going to go off and maybe I'll go to the bank. I'll leave the store at 4. Maybe I'll come back and check on my employees at night, make sure everything is fine. But it was just this crazy journey that, I mean, I was working sometimes from 4 in the morning until 11 o'clock at night. Sometimes people wouldn't show up all the time because, you know, they were sick or they were out at night. And it's hard when you're operating a smaller business and you're really counting on those key, like 8 to 10 people to show up, right? So
yeah.
Went through all of these crazy challenges that now I've learned the hard way from. And I got into staffing and recruitment with Randstad. And Randstad, to me, I just was one of the most amazing opportunities because it was getting me into this experience and this environment of really learning structure and process. And so that was one of the things that I had not studied formally yet at that point in my career. I did study for my PMP further on down the line. But going into Randstad was great because there's a lot of different sales processes and tools that are used. And so I went in as a very junior person in HR, got into that environment at a great time, obviously had a great team with me. And I was given what I call it the not Randstad material postal code. So it was L2R, L2N, and L2M, which is in Burlington and South Hamilton. And so I kind of had that manufacturing arm of Randstad, right? And so I was supposed to sell administrative and finance solutions into this very tight market it's mostly, yeah, they have a receptionist, maybe they have like an order taker, which I could still get away with in the admin world, right? But it was very tough to find the right clients. And so I had to put together strategies to really expand my business and expand my portfolio, because at the time I only had a handful of clients, and my goal was to do the business development for the market, but also provide the services. So we were running a 360 desk. So we learned a lot of amazing habits through Randstad, built my book of business again from about 3 to 5 active clients is what I adopted and started out with. Grew that to 75 active clients, and we actually work with over 300 companies by the time that I left.
So how did you do that? What was that strategy? Like, did you just knock on their doors, talk to the receptionist? What worked?
It's a great question. So I feel that with my strategies did change a little bit over time, but also depended on the market itself and the people that I was speaking with. And so what I learned, I really leaned back on my experience of being a concierge, and that, you know what, we need to be able to be relatable and to be able to adapt in certain situations. So for example, I would be going into a company like John Deere Financial, or going into Deloitte and Touche and hosting a pretty serious meeting and pitching staffing solutions for their company, which is a very buttoned down, you know, you would definitely, the expectation would be that you're dressing and you know, a nice suit or pantsuit or a dress, heels, that sort of thing. But then obviously, because I had that NRM postal code, I was also at times going into a manufacturing facility. I have tons of stories I could tell you where, you know, even sitting in a chicken producer's plant in the lobby, smelling chickens, and, you know, there's the floors are okay, and you're just waiting to have that meeting with the executive or the vice president or the president to talk about the need for an executive assistant. So In that particular environment, obviously you're going to dress a little bit different, and you're also going to behave a little bit more relaxed. So the nice thing about me, I love to just, my natural style is very easygoing. You know, I think with being a mom of 3 kids and being the oldest sister, just everything kind of rolls off your back after a while. You're just like, oh, okay, that happened. Oh, I saw that happen. Oh, someone's running around again with no underwear on down the street. Oh, no, that never happened. but you know what I'm saying, right? And so you have to think on the fly. And so I felt my strategy going into this market, it depended on the postal code territory, but then pretty specifically, if I'm going to provide some key examples of what we had to do, was really to pivot based on what was happening. in the market. So number one, we had a lot of different competitors. We had Apple One, we had Kelly Services, we have Manpower. They were already well established in that market. So we had to bring that value proposition to the table. And number one, obviously, it was getting around the idea that people thought a staffing agency is a staffing agency is a staffing agency. Because what we know as women, I think, and as people that have hired people, you're only as good as your people, right? So if I'm not delivering my what I say I'm going to do, so filling the jobs in a very timely manner, making sure that we are executing at a very high level, and I don't have a great team around me, great recruiters, we're gonna crumble. It's going to show very clearly with the clients. So we just killed it with service. That was the number one strategy, making sure that we were killing it with service, making sure that we were number two, being extremely flexible with the client. So, you know, taking that extra mile, if they needed to call me at a Friday night at 7 p.m. because they knew that they were going to have somebody not show up on Monday, or they had an issue, or they needed to fire somebody and they needed a quick replacement, you know, letting them know it's okay. Yes, we do have boundaries with family, but that we are here to service you and not to feel that you're inconveniencing us. So then we just really quickly over time, you know, everybody talks in the business community. So we really became the go-to, and we worked together as a cohesive team. So that was wonderful. It was a really magical experience for me. And then number three, I always wanted to think big picture. So I feel that anybody, wherever you're at in the sales chain, you know, whether you're just starting out as a sales assistant, or maybe you're moving up that ladder and you're at a more middle or senior level, you always need to be thinking about the whole entity of the organization. And that was something that I learned really early on in my career. So, for example, if I was going into a client and I realized that they had head offices elsewhere across the country, I would always make sure to explain to them that we are not a local staffing agency. Again, remember, not everybody had heard of us because we were not as established in that market as other competitors. So making sure that I was going and explaining that very early on, you know, hey, I noticed I looked you guys up and that you have an office located in Vancouver, BC. We actually provide services coast to coast. We're a global company. And then asking them if there was ever any opportunity to be considered for more of a national RFP or something like that, would they be open to having that conversation? So again, just a very gentle, but plant the seed and then sow it later. And it worked really well. So we brought in national accounts because just from planting that seed, and I say, keep me in mind, and then we would get on the list for the RFP. So not only were we getting a local account, but we were getting a national and sometimes an international account based on, you know, there's a lot of head offices that were located in the Burlington, Hamilton, Oakville area. So that was really how we did it. And I had an amazing team. I mean, my recruiters worked extremely hard. The team, we all worked together cohesively, and it was just a wonderful experience.
That's amazing. I love the fact that when you say, hey, look at the big picture and just keep us in mind, knowing that, hey, we service the rest of Canada. A lot of women, mm-hmm. they struggle with asking for sales. But what you just did, keep us in mind. Let us know if we can help you. That is as simple as it is. It's simply like this. Keep us posted. Let us know if we can help you. That is how we ask for sales. It's nothing awkward. It's really being in service. So I absolutely love that. And then, so after that recruiting stunt, you decided to open your own recruiting firm afterwards, right? Just like, yes. I need more challenge. So you did that. And how did that go? Yeah.
It went really well. I think I hit a wall, I think, with myself at the time, where a lot of I think as women, I'm going to go back to the motherhood aspect of things. And because I was such a young mom, I had two teenage boys in my house, and my daughter was this beautiful, wonderful preteen that, you know, I felt like she had just grown up for the last 5 or 6 years right in front of my eyes. You know, we kind of do these milestones like, I can't believe she's almost turning 10, or I can't believe she's almost turning 16, or he. Or so it was just one of those things where I realized I had really focused a lot of my career, you know, obviously number one with running the business, and then number two also with running, you know, one of the busiest staffing units in Canada for Randstad. So I felt it was time to just go, okay, I'm going to take a little bit of a breath And not in the sense that I was, you know, taking a step back in my career, but that I wanted to work smarter at that point, because my daughter, you know, I hadn't done any traveling really. You know, I had all these lists of goals that I wanted to do with my family, and I wanted a little bit more of a work-life balance, to be honest, because, you know, the careers that I had chosen and the career that I've always had has been extremely demanding. Mm-hmm. So, with a lot of different hours. So yeah, so I ended up starting a staffing firm with my partner. I actually had two partners that were working with at the time, and we worked with some really great companies. And it was a mandate for me that I wanted to make sure, obviously, that we're upholding reputation and ensuring that, you know, I'm not obviously going after any accounts that I had previously, and doing this with a strong head on my shoulders and a good heart in my approach. So reputation is, again, really, really, really important to me.
Yes, reputation is so important. Yes.
So I knew that it was going to be an uphill battle. So with literally $5,000 and hope and a prayer, we spent way too much time on getting marketing and things ready, all the things that people shouldn't be doing. It's like, pick up the phone and just call. But yeah, learn the hard way for, make the darn phone call, right?
No, I always tell people, I understand marketing is so important. I understand marketing, branding is important, but there is something that's also just as important when it comes to B2B sales, selling to businesses. It's your reputation. Mm-hmm. It's what people talk about, how people talk about you behind your, you know, your back. And it's so important. It's important to invest your time and making sure, make the phone calls. Yes. So you did that.
We did do that. Absolutely. So went out at Target. I know I just looked at job postings. So my strategy was very simple, to look at job postings that I saw that were listed that I noticed had been out for a little while, or noticed that they seemed to be increasing. And then I would call the companies up directly and let them know about my services. And I would tell them about my model, which was a little bit more unique, because at that time, I really saw that there was a need for flexible workspace, obviously post-pandemic. It's like I had a crystal ball. So just having flexible workspace, but also having flexible or mobile workforce talent. So I wanted to make sure that we were looking and targeting high potential or really high performing individuals that may come into a project or work within an organization, bring in their talents, whether it's on a short term or a longer term contract. But because we would really go through a process to make sure that our talent was really strongly vetted, where a lot of my competitors were, you know, I've seen the worst, and like, you know, not naming names, of course, but I had seen points where I myself had, you know, gone for an interview and somebody pulled out my resume off of a printout that they found online on Workopolis, and they were just sitting there. And then I found out afterwards that they had pulled my resume off a database, and then they had taken that and marketed me without my consent. And this is actually pretty common back in the day, not so much now with privacy, but back in the day, in my day, you know, we're going back, you know, 10, 12 years, that was happening way back then. But it was common with certain agencies. So we didn't obviously want to be part or associated. So we did a ton of vetting, did background checks, really looked into the history, vetted the people, and then placed them into amazing organizations that were working on municipal and also provincial, along with federal projects. So it was great. Actually, so that led me to Tim Hortons when I...
Wait, I want to backtrack on that though first.
Oh, okay, let's backtrack.
I want to just highlight that every time I hear you talking about your sales strategy, and at the beginning you talked about having a very clear value proposition. So you started your company and instantly you said, what made us unique? And I think it's so important, because big clients, they don't have time to figure out how you're different from your competitors themselves. You have to tell them, hey, here's a reason why you should hire me. Here's a reason why your life is going to be different the moment you hire me. So I love the fact that you said, okay, well, here's what makes us unique. And go ahead and go, you can go test it out and test different kinds of value proposition or positioning statement. But find one that makes you stand out, because if not, people are just going to be like, well, there's no point. I'm happy here. I'm very happy with my current vendor. Did you think that that was the reason that allowed you to see success? Or can you just elaborate that part and how important it is for your, you know, in your sales process?
Absolutely. I mean, I felt that was exactly part of the reason for the success, but also we knew that we had to deliver. And again, just making sure that we had a great process for delivering and tons of client follow-up and really wowing the client. My claim to fame, I would like to say, is I had this wonderful client. I can't name who it is, but he's north of Toronto. And one of the legends, I'm going to say absolute legends in the oil and gas industry. So he had decided to start a green energy company later on in his life. And his team had come to me after looking for a year and a half, no joke, for a very high ranking individual within his company. So they had run a number of executive and talent searches. They had engaged a number of agencies, and everybody kept sending the same people. So I knew from my experience from, you know, just the past rinse at, again, really wowing the customer, that we needed to go down, really, really drill down and ask lots of questions. So, you know, who had they seen? Why did they reject him? What wasn't meeting his expectation? Was it going to be a good fit for him? What kind of criteria would he absolutely accept or not accept? So I had a list of probably about 50 to 75 questions we had to go through for that recruit. But the thing is, if you do the work up front, this is kind of my next little nugget. If you do the work up front, it will save you so much time later. So don't be afraid to ask as many questions as possible. I truly believe like there's no silly or dumb question. And I'll even sometimes start and premise that. I'll say, you know, I'm going to ask you a lot of questions. Yeah. I hope you don't mind. But, you know, if there's something that if I repeat or if it sounds like kind of silly, I said, this is really important to me because I want to get it right. So if you set the intention early on in that conversation that I'm really just doing this to learn and grow, so we can really service you better, the client will be like, okay. Because I feel that if you don't premise that, they're like, okay, are you done? Like I got another call, right? And yeah. I've had that happen to me. So I learned that I had to change that approach, and that worked really well with him. So anyway, long story short, we ended up strategically targeting specific people that did meet that profile. We called them and gave them the job opportunity. So we pitched them on it. So we had to write, obviously, like a sales pitch, why it would be a good fit for them based on what we knew. And then we ended up successfully placing somebody within his company. And I think 8 weeks was first interview and hire was within 4 months. So
that's fast. So that's fast.
He was thrilled. So he's like, anytime you need a reference, I'm good. So it was great. It was a great experience, and it allowed me to work smarter, you know, not always be working in my business. I traveled my family across Canada. I traveled my family into the US. You know, I was able to really, because I could do my job pretty much from anywhere. So it was just having that lifestyle that I really wanted while my kids were still young enough and not, you know, working and out there. So that was really important for me to take. I call it a pause, but it really wasn't a pause. I definitely did work like my full time. But I was so used to working, I think, 80 hours or more that, you know, 30 to 40 was like a complete breeze. So
I love the fact that that's what happens when you target big companies, is that the moment you're wow one client, you're going to get that kind of amazing reference or word of mouth or referrals that bring you more big clients. If you target small clients, you're going to get more small clients. And then you just kind of like it's become, you know, there's a lot of trying to work on long hours. But if you commit to yourself and say, I am going to go after a big client, and you wow the big client, then you get the opportunity to get referrals, word of mouth, and like working with a legend and getting that knowledge and credibility working with a legend.
It was so rewarding. And I made it a personal goal. I really own it. I think you need to be absolutely with heart and mind 110% engaged. So owning that target and being alongside your client or your prospect with whatever their goal is, so that it's a very winning together approach, right? So, you know, I'm not just here to sell you. I think that's really, especially when you're selling, I don't want to say it, but you know, you're selling people, you're exchanging money, which is kind of a weird way to look at things if you think about the staffing industry as a whole, but it really is. So you have to bring that value to the table Always, because you know they can download things off the internet or they can go to a different firm provider. So it's really about building meaningful relationships.
That's amazing. Then you pivot again, and then you decide. Was it right after that you opened the franchise fix or?
No. So I've been in franchising. So kind of a little bit of a backstory is that the first business that I owned was a franchise, right? Mm-hmm. And so I actually got out of franchising and into staffing and recruiting because it was just such a great opportunity. And I think I needed to go where I thought, you know, there was a lot of potential. And obviously it was extremely rewarding for me to spend that time throughout the recruiting and that environment. And I love that. Like I can't say I regret any moment of it. And then coming out of that sort of experience, I would say having my own business, I was literally on assignment. So I was contracted out to a provincial arm, a sort of a government arm. And I was doing basically supporting the government arm with all of their recruitment efforts. So really working alongside all of the vice presidents and then making sure that they had all of their staff that was required for the initiative that they were working on at that time. So I was extremely happy. They kept renewing the consulting contract that I had. I was spending a lot of time downtown Toronto doing the train. It was great. I was living the dream.
That's amazing.
I loved it. It was great. It was just, I love the team. They were actually I still speak with a couple of the people from the team and they were just so amazing. I don't even know how to describe, like they were just the most warmest, caring, amazing team. Nothing was ever too big of a challenge for me. I mean, I love one of my executive vice presidents that I had to support. You know, he always used to say, I go through my executive assistants like I go through water. And he said, so you better make sure you find me the right one because I don't want to go through another one. And he ended up, you know, he found a great lady. And here's the best story is that he said, I need to take you up for lunch and talk to you. And I said, okay, so we go out for lunch and we're talking about his mandate. He said, guess what? He goes, I know I can trust you because my wife, you wouldn't know her because she has this different last name than I do, but she was actually one of your candidates back 8 years ago when you were at Randstad. And so I told her that you were on my team and she remembered you and your service. And she said, no, Angelie's good. You're going to be fine. And so that, and this was a guy that was so difficult, like very high performer. So, you know, very high standards, right? I love people like that because I get it. So it's just, okay, great. But it really got him to relax and build that trust, right? Mm-hmm. So you never know who you're going to run into, whether you're 25, 30, 35, 40, or how that person may interact with you in your future life. I have a lot of side stories that we could talk about as well. But yeah, so I was at my assignment. They were ready to renew my contract. And I got a call from a headhunter of all things. Mm-hmm. And they said that, Tim Hortons was looking for somebody. They had an open mandate for about 8 months. They were looking to fill and they were needing somebody that had a recruitment background, but also had a franchise background. And so after going through a series, and it's Tim Hortons, right? I mean, it was at the time pre-3G, so pre-sale, I like to call it. I had a really interesting list of deliverables that I had to execute on. And it was one of those things where I mean, I couldn't say no. It was Tim Hortons. I mean, like, oh my gosh, go work for Canada's favorite coffee, for the best franchise and the largest franchise system in Canada, one of the most successful. I gotta go. So I literally shut down my business. I passed all the responsibility over to my business partner just to finish off the mandates. Obviously, I was still doing a lot of the 360 desks. So closed off that business and then started with Tim Hortons in 2013.
Okay. And then you did a little bit of corporate thing. And what made you decide that you're going to start your own company again with Franchise Fix?
Yeah. Well, I mean, after I built up the experience in franchising with the being with a global company and a lot of the work that I did, obviously at that point, I'm an entrepreneur at heart. And it got to a point again where my kids had now grown up. And so I actually have a daughter now who's, my daughter is 19. I talk a lot about her, you know, so she's ready to go off to university. She wants to actually be a psychologist. So she's got, I'm kind of at that nice sweet spot. So about a year and a half ago, I saw down the tunnel of, okay, great. I have to now start future planning for the next 5, 10, 15 years as I'm getting older in my career. And I'm, you know, things like dealing with an aging parent and also having a child that might be going off to university and my oldest son, you know, in a relationship and thinking about what happens if they get married and, you know, they want to have babies. So I really try to always think about my family first. You know, I'm a very family centric person. My kids are my best friends. So, you know, we do a lot of stuff together all the time, 24/7, which is kind of weird, but it's even my adult kids, they will pop by the house any given day. They'll just drive by, hey, you know, mom, pop in, how's it going? We talk to each other, text all the time. So we're very close. And so I wanted to think about that family unit. Mm-hmm. And it was just one of those moments in my life where I thought, okay, I think I've built enough expertise and experience at this point where I can take the knowledge and skills that I've learned and develop it into a model where I saw a gap. And for me, I really always try to see opportunity and also areas of improvement. So that was one of the things that I really learned from back at Tim Hortons. We did a lot of high level project work, process improvement project work as well, to really bring in efficiencies into a mature organization, which is no easy feat because in terms of a change management perspective, you are always working with, you know, very high senior level stakeholders. You're also steering a ship of habits, and you're working through those relationships also as you're still newer to the company as well. So I felt that I had done an amazing job. Obviously, I know I did an amazing job. I'll correct that, because a lot of those VPs and executives that I had worked with, we've become great friends. We still communicate regularly. We sit on committees and boards together. So if they didn't like me, I mean, they would have lost my number, right? So I feel it was a great opportunity and great time and place. But obviously, with all of the changes happening in franchising, I really wanted to just fill the gap. And the gap that I saw specifically in franchising was that there was a lot of franchise systems. So franchisors out there, that they have their corporate guidelines, their manual, their expectations. They would have an amazing team, you know, behind them to push them out. And then you had your franchisees, that entrepreneur that maybe they have one location or five locations or 10 locations, and they're trying to follow these policies and procedures. You know, they're trying to manage their and juggle their business on a daily basis. They want to grow and they don't want to be left behind. So, you know, they're looking for opportunity, but then there's holes, right? Because those holes happen, I mean, for a number of reasons, but really the fix comes in where let's look at and identify some of those holes and work in conjunction, because, you know, we do understand the franchisor because we work with franchisors. Mm-hmm. And also let's fill in the gaps and work with the franchisee as well, because we've been franchisees. So what my team does is that we come in and we'll help people with whatever that hole or that gap is and help them build strategy, and then help them execute and guide them to complete that strategy work. So, you know, it could be something as simple as a gap being they've been trying to increase their revenue. It could be a gap that they're having hiring turnover issues. It could be a gap that they need to market more franchises because, you know, maybe they haven't been able to bring in enough franchisees and, you know, their mission this year is to really grow. So let's work on a strategy to improve that and then build some successes together. And, you know, and the nice thing about the fix is that we'll get clients for life. You know, they'll come back to us for whatever solution. I have about 65 people that I work with on a regular basis, all top performers within the hub, I like to call it. So it's really nice. I can kind of pick and choose, like, this person would be really good for you. So again, pulling in my recruiting background of picking in great talent that I have contractual relationships with, and some of them also, of course, being associates of mine as well.
That's amazing. And there's one thing I like to ask you in terms of strategy. Oftentimes, we work women entrepreneurs. There are a lot of consultants and coaches. And some of the struggles we often face is that how do you tell your clients or your prospective clients that, hey, you've got a challenge without offending them? For example, what I'm seeing here is it's one thing to say, hey, we fixed your franchise system, but how do you initially approach them when you say, hey, you've got a hole? No one wants to admit that they've got holes anywhere. Everybody's doing fine. Everybody's great. How do you kind of start that conversation without offending sometimes, you know, very macho or people with certain amount of ego? And how do you start that conversation and allow people to open up to you and to talk about their challenges?
Absolutely. So that's a really great question. So I'm laughing because I'm thinking about some very relevant situations that just came up recently. And so I would love to say that I'm always 100% perfect every single time with execution and delivery, but I would be lying. I'm still learning because the model is a couple of years old. So we're still building it. So quite often people will come to me because they are a referral or they know me, maybe they've sat at a round table that I've hosted or they've heard my name around the table within associations. So I think building that reputation and trust, again, is extremely important in your career. So whatever you want to do, if you want to be a salesperson, whether you're at A company, B company, C company, and just always acting appropriately and keeping that great reputation is extremely important. And so, yeah, like that's a lot of the companies that come to me are through referrals. And mm-hmm. So it's a more of a softer or a warmer lead, I would like to call it. But drilling down is definitely a challenge. So I always like to set the stage. And this is what I do. Again, going back to wearing my process hat is I just walk them through. This is our process. So they don't know any different, you know. So to them, it's you know, think about going to your business psychologist, right, if you will. So it's like, okay, great. So tell me a little bit about you. Tell me about your company. Let's walk through some of your vision. Tell me about, you know, what's going on right now. Why did you call me? You know, and just kind of making it really, really soft. And then, okay, now, you know what? Thanks so much for sharing. We have a list of questions that I really like to spend the next 10 or 15 minutes. This is very standard. You know, if there's some that we can't really get to right now, great. We can always come back to it. But this will be really important for me to help you. And so it's using that language, I feel. Again, I deal with a lot of men. So I'm 95% of the clients that I deal with are men. There's only 4% of leadership roles in Canada right now that are held by women in my industry. So it's very, very, very small. It's very tight. And so you have to be soft, but you need to be firm. So, and you have to read your client. So I can give you an example of one of my clients. He's a very soft, big picture thinker. And I have literally daily task reminders that go out to him for things that he needs to do on his checklist for him to execute his vision. And he's like, could I do that on day one? No. But he said, I actually really appreciate you being able to give me that checklist, because he's like, I'm looking forward to that now. I need someone to keep me accountable. And I appreciate that because I know there's going to be an end result and he can see how it's forming. But it's, you have to really read your audience and go slow. A bad example I have is I actually had a prospect that I didn't end up doing business with. But overall, I mean, not every prospect is the right fit. And I think that's important for us to consider as well, that in terms of your client list and building, I always talk to people when I do coaching is to think about your dream target list and the key clients that you really want to work with. And targeting those individuals and those organizations that you think would be a great fit for you, not only in your value system, but also, you know, somebody that you could just see yourself really working with, right? And fill it out there. And I think if you really visualize it, that does help you, because then when you come across somebody that you're like doing a little bit of that gut check or that test inside, okay, is this somebody that, you know, are they really meeting my benchmark for what kind of person I like to work with, what kind of organization I want to work with? Do our goals and values align? And, you know, sometimes we have to walk away because it's best for both of us. Maybe it's just not the right fit. And for me, I'd rather walk away from a sale that I know may not work out in the long run than try to hammer a square peg into a round hole. Mm-hmm. So I have one of those situations that happened recently where would I have loved the business and maybe putting money in my bank account and, you know, taking that money and investing it? Okay, great. But his values were not aligned with mine. And so I did refer him to somebody that I felt would be a better fit for him. So again, just providing that loop and that service as well, even though I didn't receive any business out of it.
All right. So for you, Franchise Fix, I mean, we've really gone through your entire sales journey. Now, Franchise Fix is 2021, your baby. Have you seen a change in terms of prospecting strategies? What works best for you? I think you kind of shared a little bit with us about the roundtables you're hosting, you seem to be hosting, or business associations. Do you see sales different compared to when you started originally back then? I remember we talked about this back then when there was no LinkedIn, and then now there's LinkedIn. There's all those, Zoom and things like that. Have you seen change, and what works for you now?
That's before LinkedIn, what did we do?
Life before LinkedIn and life after LinkedIn.
It's crazy. Well, back when I was in staffing, right? And I would hear the stories about the Rolodex, and that was a joke in staffing because there were still people in our industry that didn't have a CRM when I first started. Obviously, we had all the tools, I loved the tools that we did have. But many people just had a great list of people that they knew, and that was how it was done back in the day. And I've seen that change in franchising as well. So the way we target franchise recruitment and bring in great franchisees, there's a bit of a change that's happening or over the last 5, 6 years as well, with leveraging a lot more social media and different strategies. So in terms of how it's changed my approach to business development, I feel that I look for champions. So I think that's really important in my industry, being a female and dealing, and I think with the amount of guys that I do, and I feel like I have 100 brothers. So the way I look at my clients is I look at them as partners. Some of them, we have. They might come off and become friends of mine and be closer to my family. It just really depends on that business relationship. But if you have those champions that, these might be people that I have provided services to, or people that I maybe have referred, and we start getting to know each other, having a couple of key champions, especially through COVID, was really paramount for me. So people that were close to me, knew me as a person, trusted me, I trusted them, and just reaching out to them and asking them, I'm really working to build my business. I would love if you just maybe had a couple of people that you think would be on your list that you wouldn't mind referring for me, or doing just an introduction, and a warm introduction could be by email or maybe just a Zoom. I would love to have you. And that really helped me. And so instead of doing cold call, cold call, cold call, cold call, LinkedIn reach out, not that I'm knocking LinkedIn reach outs because I do think they do work very well. Obviously, we wouldn't have met. And I think they're a fabulous tool. But when you're building a business, when you're starting up from zero and you need to, again, I built this on no money at all. Like, I didn't invest a single penny into my business other than putting together my website and getting up and running for the logo and things like that that I had to do. But it was basically starting from the ground up and going from there. And so just reaching out to my champions and the people that I knew, informing them of what I was doing, and then asking for some introductions.
Wow. And I mean, I think for whoever's listening to this, I hope you can understand or can see how easy sales or asking for sales can be, how it can be. It's really not complicated. A lot of times we overcomplicating things, but all you're doing is picking up the phone and just share your dream, your vision with somebody you trust and ask them, can you help me? Do you know anybody that would be able to help me achieve my dreams? And that's it. Wow, I'm taking down notes. There's so much amazing lessons and things that I hear from this from your story. If you were to tell a female entrepreneur going after big clients, what would be the advice, like one advice you want to give to fellow women out here, and in terms of their sales?
Oh, wow. Go for it. Make sure you build a plan. So I will say, but don't be afraid. I always feel that if you can, the best way to control or feel that you can control the outcome of a situation is to use visualization techniques and also plan and rehearse. So that was an important strategy that I used, especially when I was new. I mean, I wasn't, when I started off in staffing or even franchising, this super experienced, you know, 10-year veteran, and I had a whole slew of references behind me, right? So I always used to joke with my own sales team, sometimes you just have to fake it till you make it, right? Mm-hmm. And I know it's so cliche, but it's so true. And how you really do that is by repeating that, right? So, and especially if you're new and being a new entrepreneur, again, you don't have that resource that you can lean on of experience. So it's really practicing your pitch, making sure that you're clear and concise, doing your research about the organization, even if you can, obviously researching the person that you're meeting with on LinkedIn, getting a feel for who they are as an individual, if you can, if they have a LinkedIn, you know, even doing Google searches, media searches about that individual, having a couple of really great key talking points, so things that you might be able to relate on, and also considering if you're meeting with a man versus meeting with a woman, because there is a difference in approach sometimes. Not always. So I like to say, if I'm dealing with somebody that is, say, a woman in operations, typically operations people are very direct, to the point. They just want the bullet list. They don't like the fluff. And that's cool. Love those kinds of people. And then when you go into the HR side, or maybe a female executive, it might be more of that relatability relationship. You know, maybe we start off a conversation that is a little bit softer, but then we get down to business. But that depends. And it's really, you know, you've got to read it once you get there, if you've never met with them face to face or on a Zoom yet. But prepare, practice, you know, do it in a mirror, make sure that you're confident when you're talking about your business, you know your pitch, you know what your services are, you know how they're different, do your research on anything that you possibly can. I think just as much as possible, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that people buy still from people that they like and trust. So if you're able to get through that hurdle of making sure that you can prove your value early on, that will help you succeed. Maybe not right off the bat, right? But if you try, you will definitely hit the target. Absolutely. So it's not, I don't want to say it's not that difficult, but honestly, if you follow like a very simple process for being able to be successful and visualizing your success and walking out of that meeting, winning that account, it will happen. I'm a huge believer of that.
Yeah. And yeah, it's about owning yourself, owning that vision, and telling yourself that, yes, I can do it and I can go after big clients. Mm-hmm. Anjalee, thank you so much for sharing your experience. I think the listeners, they're going to learn so much from your journey and your story. For anybody who would like to connect with her, make sure she's on LinkedIn, and I'll make sure to connect to share her LinkedIn URL with you all. And again, thank you so much, Anjalee, for sharing this experience. We need more women like you going after big clients.
Oh, well, thank you. Thank you so much for the opportunity. And I really look forward to hopefully connecting with you again in the future. And again, anybody else wants to reach out, no problem. Happy to help.
All right.